You get the statement of the 26 scientists that we called together to study the safety of genetically engineered crops. And after several years of frustration, they wrote an open letter to the EPA stating that because genetically engineered products are proprietary products, the companies refuse to provide access to them for safety study. Those few who've been able to obtain them are denied the opportunity to present their data. And in several cases where that access has been obtained because the companies couldn't control the isogenic lines because they were developed by a university or by another government agency, and they refused to grant that privilege of keeping everything confidential, they've been threatened with a lawsuit to destroy their career if they do publish it. And so you're kept in the dark. Most of you probably haven't seen those curves before. I served for 8 years on the global, on the quadripartite epidemiology committee for our Surgeon General. A retired colonel, retired as associate director of the Armed Forces Medical Intelligence Center. When we would see a curve like that happening anywhere in the world, we'd say, what's changed?
Aloha, Dr. Huber. This is Erica Morningstar, and I'm so happy to be with you here today and to have the opportunity to ask you a few questions. I'm wondering if you could just start by explaining briefly who you are and a little bit about your credentials.
I'm Don Huber, emeritus professor of plant pathology at Purdue University. Also served a number of capacities with the government and Surgeon General's office for global epidemiology, international diseases, and that type of program, but have 55 years of research in agricultural disease control and microbial interaction.
Wow, that's quite a resume. I think that the words that I would use to describe how I felt after I saw your presentation at KCC are, you know, shock and horror when I really realized the global implications of the research that you're presenting on how the use of Roundup Ready crops, genetically modified with glyphosate, are impacting our world. And it's really altering the epigenetics of our world from what I'm understanding. So if you could just briefly explain to, you know, our audience how glyphosate is a chelating agent that blocks micronutrient absorption and acts as an endocrine disruptor.
Well, glyphosate is a very unique herbicide, weed killer. What most people don't realize is that the way it kills weeds is by giving them a bad case of AIDS. In other words, it chelates or it ties up critical nutrients in the plant so that the plant can no longer defend itself against diseases, and therefore the weeds are a plant that's treated with glyphosate, dies from infection rather than directly from the chemical.
Ah,
And doing that, it also ties up those nutrients for a long time until that chelation, until that bonding can be broken, so that we have fewer nutrients in our food. We have difficulty for the plant to even obtain nutrients from the soil. But it's glyphosate is also a very powerful antibiotic. Mm-hmm. Actually patented as an antibiotic. So it's a unique chemical. And as in that uniqueness, it has many effects well beyond weed control. Those impact everything that we do. It impacts our own physiology, our own ability to obtain nutrients and to have those nutrients available then for our metabolism. So we become nutrient deficient, iron deficient, manganese deficient, vitamin B12 deficient. And because all of those vitamins and nutrients are chelated by glyphosate and immobilized from a functional standpoint.
Wow, so it affects the human absorption of nutrients as well as the plant absorption of nutrients.
Yes, it does that directly by chelating, by immobilizing them, but also through that antibiotic effect that destroys the beneficial microorganisms that we rely on to digest our food, mm-hmm. or to provide farms of those nutrients that are available for us to absorb through the intestinal wall and utilize that way.
Right, that would be like leaky gut syndrome.
Right.
Right, okay. So can you just explain briefly how this, you know, impacts humans kind of as a whole when we ingest glyphosate through soil, through food, or through other environmental factors? Like, what does that mean for humanity as a whole?
There, for one thing, we have less nutrient-dense foods so that we're not getting all of the nutrients that we need for our bodies to properly function. With the antibiotic effect then of glyphosate, it destroys many of those organisms that we also have to absorb that food, or for both the plants as well as animals to obtain those nutrients, because glyphosate is also very toxic mm-hmm. to many of those organisms in the soil that make nutrients available for plant uptake.
Right.
Now, those microorganisms are the ones that protect us from some very serious pathogens, from botulism, from salmonella, and from E. coli. Those are big words, I know, but they're also, they've been in the news continuously now for about 10 years because we see an epidemic. And we have to have a continuous recall, it seems like, of a lot of our food products because they're contaminated now with those pathogens, because we don't have the natural controls, those organisms that would naturally control those serious disease organisms are very sensitive to glyphosate and have been killed.
Wow. And one of the things that really struck me in your presentation was when you were talking about the new mycotoxin that's been recently discovered in GMO glyphosate sprayed crops and like cattle feed that may be attributing to up to a 50% infertility or loss of babies in livestock, cattle, pigs, chickens, you know, whatever livestock are eating this feed, and that this could be attributing to a 30% drop in human fertility worldwide?
Yes, this entity will kill a fertilized chicken embryo, for instance, in 24 to 48 hours.
Wow.
It causes infertility in both male and females, and also spontaneous abortion or miscarriage of a developing fetus, so that we see a tremendous impact, not only in animal production, but also impacting us as humans, because it causes that reproductive failure in cattle and horses, pigs, chickens, goats, and humans. So it's not just limited to an impact on plants, where we think that it increases the severity of some of our plant diseases, but it impacts essentially across the board a large number of animals and species.
Wow. So I just want to reiterate that, because I think it's so powerful. I just want to make sure that all of our listeners are understanding that this is a mycotoxin that is existing in genetically modified crops that are sprayed with glyphosate, and that this mycotoxin impacts human fertility and causes infertility or miscarriage, essentially.
We use the mycotoxin in a little different term. It's an electron microscopic sized organism.
Okay.
About the size of a very small virus.
About the size of a very small virus.
But it's not a virus. It's new to science, as far as our understanding. It's not new to nature, we're sure, but it's new to science. And it seems to be new to this role that it has in causing miscarriages and infertility.
Wow.
So.
Well, since, you know, you've got the process of lateral gene transfer that can happen with genetically modified crops, I mean, there's no telling what kind of new organism has possibly been created, through that process. So that's very serious, and that was a big concern to me in your presentation. So I'm wondering if you could also explain how glyphosate and Roundup Ready crops may correlate with the unprecedented rise in over 35 serious diseases worldwide.
Its impact, and Dr. Sanef and Samsel have a very excellent paper out, scientific paper now, from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where they have connected the dots biochemically with glyphosate and the GMO protein as it affects those specific interactions that involve all of those gut diseases. In other words, those diseases that are influenced by changes in the microflora, the organisms in our intestine and our GI tract. So with glyphosate's antibiotic activity, it's very toxic to those organisms.
Mm-hmm.
And then as a mineral immobilizer, are those critical nutrients that would keep our resistance up to those diseases also. The two all work together, or both those mechanisms work together to increase the severity of autism, Parkinson's, leaky gut, Crohn's, celiac disease, gluten intolerance there.
Uh-huh.
But also these other diseases that we could go on and name, but they all are a result of that antibiotic and chelating effect of glyphosate that changes them. The ability of the body to respond and throw off those diseases.
Right. Okay. And so you kind of explained briefly on glyphosate's, you know, link to autism. Where do you see the autism rates headed by looking at the data and the research and our use of glyphosate and GMO crops? Where do you see those rates headed in the future unless we take some kind of action now? Like, if we stopped all GMO crops and all Roundup now, would we see a drop in autism, or have we, like, already caused some damage for the future? What are we looking at here?
Well, there's always a lag of 6 to 10 or 12 years in medical data, so the data that we have today is going to continue to increase, or the recorded account is going to continue to increase. Certainly the quicker we can stop and the quicker that we can obtain remediation for the damage that's done, the less damage will be done in the future. But we've gone from 1 to 2 cases per 100,000 40 years ago to about 1995, I think it was 1 in 216 in North America. It then increased to 1 in 88, 1 in 50 right now, and by 2020, or in 7 years, it's estimated that maybe as high as 1 in 2 children will be born autistic.
That's absolutely horrifying to me, and it's unacceptable to me, and I think it should be unacceptable, you know, to every single human on this planet that is happening. I'm just stunned. Like, I don't even know how to respond when I hear that kind of data. My next question is, I just have 2 more quick questions because I know you're in a rush. Using glyphosate and on genetically modified crops, it impacts the soil microbes, and it also has a genetic impact on the soil as far as promiscuous genes or lateral gene transfer. So once you've grown these crops in the soil, how many years or how long is it that those promiscuous genes remain in the soil? And my understanding from what you said is that you can grow a crop there years later and still have those GMO genes transfer from the soil into the new crop and cause it to be contaminated. Is that correct?
That's correct. We know that with the starling genes from corn, the early genetically engineered corn that was producing a pharmaceutical product, which is very toxic to humans. And those genes during decomposition of the corn stubble apparently are picked up by the soil microorganisms, and it gives it perpetuation in the soil, and then those can be transferred to corn crop that's grown later on that same soil. So part of the problem is that we know how to get these genes in, we don't know how to get them out. And once they're in the environment, we know that they're not going to stay just where we think they are thought that they would stay, but they're moving in a number of ways, both into the soil microorganisms, they're moving through pollen flow or gene flow to other crops, but also then when we eat those foods, there's evidence now that those nucleic acid chunks that were kind of thrown in more like a virus infection than a gene program, that our own body or our own microorganisms in our intestinal tract can pick up those genes and then produce those toxic products, so that we can become allergic to ourselves, essentially.
Wow.
In that process, there's so many things that we don't know about genetic engineering that should be known and should have been determined long before we had introduced this massive experiment to expose the entire population.
Wow. And I guess from my last question is, you just briefly touched on how, you know, GMO crops and especially in combination with the glyphosate can laterally gene transfer in our own bodies once we've ingested them, and can cause us to actually become BT toxin or pesticide producing humans. It's like an epigenetic change of the entire human race, essentially. And can you just touch on that just briefly to kind of wrap up what the consequences are for humanity if we keep going down this trail? What's going to happen?
Well, of course, any time that you disrupt the integrity of the genetic code in any organism, you have all kinds of mutations and teragenetic effects, all kinds of changes. We see that with the gene inserts, which is a common form of genetic engineering now. They're promoting, and the companies are asking to be able to use another form of genetic engineering, and that's a form that shuts down the gene and gene action, gene silencing. Mm-hmm. That's even more damaging because those transformations are even less stable than the ones that we're seeing today, and they're much more easily picked up by our own genetic code, or again, the code or the genetic code of the microorganisms in our own bodies. So
they could silence genes within our own bodies. It could completely transform the human race, in other words, in well, ways that we don't know or understand yet.
That would be, the end potential of that. We don't know. The research has never been required. It's been considered so safe that nobody has ever been required to do the research. But the independent peer-reviewed scientific data on these processes says that they're not safe, that all of these things can happen. We have them documented in commerce that they have happened. We just had an event with the Roundup Ready wheat showing up in Oregon. That field had never grown Roundup Ready wheat. All of the Roundup Ready wheat was supposedly destroyed 8 to 10 years ago. Well, how did that persist in a wheat crop that's not even the same type of wheat, not grown in the same field? How did those genes get there?
Wow. So all of these fields around the world, all of this land that's being converted to grow GMO crops, you know, like here in Kauai, we have 15,000 acres of land growing GMO crops, and they could be basically permanently contaminating the soil genetically for a very long time to make it difficult for us to even feed ourselves. If the barge stopped coming and we had to grow food to feed ourselves, that land would be contaminated with genes that are growing corn that's essentially unfit for human consumption. It's basically biofuel corn. And is that kind of, is that what you're, I want to make sure I'm understanding?
That would be certainly a potential from that.
Wow.
We don't know. We don't know what the length of time or the persistence is.
Wow.
We do know that with glyphosate, that it can be a very persistent chemical. It may be detoxified, but it, the courts have repeatedly ruled, in spite of all the comments on the labels from the companies, but the courts have repeatedly ruled that it's fraud to claim biodegradability of glyphosate because it's not a predictable entity.
Wow.
And yet here you have this very powerful antibiotic, very strong chelator to immobilize nutrients that can persist in the soil for a long time.
Well, Dr. Huber, thank you so much for this interview. I can smell right now that you have some delicious food delivered over here, and I don't want your dinner to get cold, so I'm going to let you go. And I just express gratitude from the bottom of my heart for you getting this message out to the world and telling the truth to people. The truth needs to be heard, and I will definitely share this message and this interview and wish you well and hope that people hear your message and understand the implications.
Many thanks for the opportunity, and we didn't cover those opportunities for remediation and a lot of those things. It's not a hopeless situation, but certainly one that with the health and safety factors and the escalating diseases across such a broad spectrum, it needs to be addressed immediately. We need to change. You can't bring about change doing the same thing that you've been doing that got you into this point. So, many thanks.
Mahalo, Doctor.
Farmers Association, or Stock Growers Association, gave testimony before the Senate Ag Committee, testified of two conditions that were threatening the viability of the industry. One's premature aging. You take a prime beef, 18, 24 months old, should command a premium price, and it's graded down as though it's a 12-year-old colt coming out of the dairy. Premature aging. The other condition was reproductive failure. As many as 40 to 50% of the cattle in some herds losing pregnancies, miscarriage, or spontaneous abortion. You're not going to maintain a dairy very long if you can't have pregnancies. I'll show you that data here after this. This is a study that was conducted in Iowa 4 years ago, comparing GMO with non-GMO fed cattle. You can see the premature aging and that yellowing of the stomach lining. Other aspects of that allergy response from those foreign proteins that are supposed to be readily digested that aren't. And they're also not always very quickly passed through the GI tract. But you can see why they're graded down. They're not the prime beef that the farmer wants to be proud of raising and thinks that he's providing. Again, the reproductive failure is a very serious problem. The fertility rate in the Western world dropped 30% in the last 5 years. That's the second drop in 10 years in fertility. Look at these dairies. This article in Hortz Dairyman, November 2011, was written by two veterinarians that studied this problem, reproductive failure, in all of North America, from Mexico to Canada. Said we can't figure out what's going on. Said we don't think it's in the nutrition because every dairy has a nutritionist. But it's in the feed. And what you see here, 27% of those three dairies where they've lost pregnancy. They were checked. They knew that they were carrying a calf. You look at the pigs. We've gone from 11 to 13 or on up to 15 pigs per litter down to 5 to 8 pigs per litter. You have some herds that it's 70% pseudo-pregnancy. In other words, there is a pregnancy there, and then a month and a half or 2 months later, the cycling, hormonal cycling, is starting again, and the animal is no longer pregnant. They've lost that pregnancy. Had a woman in California call me. After she had heard me talk at Des Moines, Iowa, went back home and gave me a call. Said, this was a couple of weeks after the meeting. Said, I want to tell you what happened in our family. Said, my five-year-old came home from kindergarten. And he said, Mom, said, why don't I have any brothers and sisters? She said, you do. You've got an older brother and a younger sister. He said, no, all my classmates have brothers and sisters, but I don't. She started checking around with other parents in the class. They're the only family in that community that's been able to have children normally. All of his classmates have had children by in vitro fertilization. What do you get with in vitro fertilization? Usually twins and sometimes triplets. He had brothers and sisters in his own class. We have 14 fertility clinics for every one that we had 20 years ago. 2000 or 1998, we had a large increase in miscarriage and abortions in one area of the country. We could rule out the botoxins, PRRS virus, and all of the other known causes of miscarriage. Some of those breeding animals were worth several million dollars, and the veterinarian was told that if he wanted to keep his job, he was going to find out what was happening. The next year, rather than it being just a bubble, it increased in incidence and number of farms that were involved. Finally, and as a matter of just trying to understand what was happening physiologically, this veterinarian went to the electron microscope and was looking for any abnormality in the fetal tissue or amniotic fluid or placenta, anything else that might describe or might define what was going on. What he found was this electron microscopic sized entity. They listed as a suspect because they'd never seen it before, and it is 35-year veterinary practice. And so as he looked at it and he's followed up on it, he said, well, I think that it's involved. I don't know what it is. But he continued then to see if he could isolate it, and in 2005, he was finally able to culture it in pure culture. He grew it up. He first isolated it from an aborted fetus, grew it up in pure culture, reintroduced it to the animal, reproduced the miscarriage, and then re-isolated it from that tissue. We call that Koch's postulates, which establishes the cause-effect relationship. He then said, if this is the cause, where are the animals getting it? He went to the soybean meal in the feed, and it's just loaded. 98% of our soybeans are Roundup ready. We find it in high concentrations in corn, GMO corn. We find it in GMO soybeans. Find it in a number of other crops. Higher concentrations even in silage than in the grain. And the silage or the fermenting process appears to increase the concentration of this abortogenic agent so that dairies and cattlemen and hog farmers that are using distiller's grain from the ethanol or the biodiesel process and feeding that protein are feeding very high concentrations of this abortogenic agent. It causes reproductive failure, infertility in males, infertility in females, and miscarriage then of a fetus in cattle, horses, sheep, pigs, goats, poultry, and humans. We haven't been able to put a name on it. We've narrowed it down to one of three entities. Either a new life form, which means that it'll have DNA. There's some indications that may be a possibility. It's very slow growing, very difficult to get enough material for our DNA sequencing. We also have evidence that it may be what we call a biomatrix. Up until 2010, this was referred to as a nanobacter. It's not a living entity, but it's a self-replicating entity. Actually chelates amino acids, forms a protein sheath, much like a virus does. Our protein strands look very much like a prion. Dr. Michael Antonio at King's College, who is the world's authority on prions and mad cow disease, said for him to just look at it in his early analysis, he would say 95% that it's a prion. Now, others would say at 95% that it's a biomatrix. Biomatrixes are known in medicine. They're associated with Lyme disease, with atherosclerosis, with arthritis. A number of those things, very critical role in a lot of those. But we see this in those situations where we have a GMO crop or high usage of glyphosate in the system. This study that was just published, peer-reviewed scientific study conducted 3 years ago in Iowa again of pigs fed GMO versus non-GMO feed. This is a long-term full feeding study, the only one of its kind. The only other study that long-term study is a Cirillini study that I'll show you in a minute, which is the lifetime of the rats. This is the feeding lifetime, you might say, of the animals from weaning to marketing. A pig stomach will look very much like ours. You have a normal stomach over here on the left, And then you have the GMO stomach. You see that allergy response to those foreign proteins. You'll see microscopic lesions or ulceration. The title of the paper is Stomach Erosion from GMO Proteins. You see the intestine breaking down and leaky gut and all of the associated problems. It's a different microflora that you have in that intestinal tract. The veterinarian said it was so putrid that they had a hard time even wanting to be in the presence of it. That's not the case with a normal stomach. It has a smell to it, but it's sure not that rank that you would express it that way. They used another term, and that's that its consistency was more like a pile of snot than it was a biological tissue. And I apologize to those of you who are sensitive to that term. There is no other term that they could give me to use. But the deterioration, and then you look at, as I'll show you, what's happening to our health relative to those gut-type diseases like Crohn's and gluten intolerance or celiac, or even Parkinson's and autism and Alzheimer's. Well, what do we do if our children can't tolerate cow's milk or breast milk? We put them on soybean meals or soybean milk. And then we wonder why we still have all the problems. Again, glyphosate is supposed to be so safe because we didn't have the chikimate pathway, and this is the pathway that you see here. You see where those micronutrients are involved in those many physiological processes that are there to keep us healthy, to keep us growing in a normal manner. You see all of those plant hormones coming through this process, as well as the stress defense. But our intestinal microorganisms are critically sensitive to glyphosate. One of the diseases that has been escalating, along with 33 others, is chronic fatigue syndrome in man. In animals, we call it chronic botulism. We have dairies that are losing 1 and 2 cows a month, and 1 or 2 of them have been losing 1 or 2 a week, until they go bankrupt from this disease. You can see the normal stomach on the left, and you see what happens when there's 1/10 of a part per million glyphosate in the feed that those animals are eating. Because you see the bloody rumen, you'll see large ulcerations or holes in the rumen and the cud, partially digested food, drops from the rumen then down into the other rest of the stomach area, or the true stomach area, only partially digested to create all the other disturbances then that you get in the system. But if you look at the impact of that 1/10 of a part per million glyphosate on just one organism, that's Enterococcus faecalis. As long as that organism is healthy, growing in the intestinal tract, and lactobacillus and bifidobacterium will do the same thing. And we usually have a whole range of organisms that are acting together there. But as soon as you take them out with the glyphosate, you can see where that blue bar has gone. Then you see Clostridium botulinum take off. This is an organism that's everywhere in the environment. It's in the dust, it's in feed, it's in food. But it doesn't do any damage if we have a healthy GI tract. When you kill those organisms that protect you from these serious pathogens, then you see them developing because there aren't any voids in nature. You merely shift the population from a beneficial one to one that is fatal. You see the botulism neurotoxin. Again, every case of SIDS that they've been able to analyze require the bot neurotoxin has shown that sudden infant death syndrome is from a disruption of that biological flora that suppresses the clostridium. The symptom of the bot neurotoxin is respiratory failure. The symptom of sudden infant death syndrome is respiratory failure. It's not how the baby's laying in the bed. It's what's happened to that intestinal microflora. It's why the American Academy of Pediatricians has encouraged mothers to breastfeed for at least a year. A year and a half's even better, because it's that breast milk that provides the lactobacillus and the bifidobacteria as a probiotic to colonize that intestine of the developing child, to prevent Clostridium bot toxin from having an effect. Paper that was just released a few months ago on poultry. 2 years ago, we had to recall 20% of our total egg production because of salmonella contamination. Newspaper articles said, well, when the inspectors got to the egg farm, to the poultry farm, said they found chicken manure there. Well, my kids have had usually about 300 chickens for 4-H projects, long as I can remember. We always had chicken manure when we had chickens. The other thing they said is there were mice dropping. If you're gonna have feed around for the chickens, you're gonna have some mice in spite of a rat terrier and a bunch of pretty good mice, or pretty good cats. You don't get them all. That's not the problem. The problem was that we destroyed the natural biological controls that in the past we didn't have to worry about. Because the lactobacillus and the bifidobacterium, the pseudomonas and the regular bacillus and a number of other organisms kept those pathogens that are ubiquitous or everywhere in the environment under control. We didn't have to worry about them at all. When we use this broad spectrum antibiotic that we call glyphosate or Roundup herbicide, use it indiscriminately on everything from a concrete sidewalk to keep the weeds out of the cracks for our gardens and roadways and right-of-ways, and then dump it right on our crops and our food, is it any wonder that we've upset the ecological relationship that used to protect us very effectively? You can see all of those organisms in the chicken's GI tract. They're very sensitive to glyphosate. Those are your policemen. Those are your soldiers on the front line for your defense. And then look at what happens to all of those very serious pathogens that are also in the environment that fill that void that we've created through the indiscriminate use of this strong chelator and chemical. 50% of the world's bees, honeybees, have been destroyed and died from colony collapse disorder in the last 15 years. We say we're not sure what caused it. Neonicotinamide and insecticides are probably involved because they're very strong endocrine hormone disruptors. Glyphosate is also a very strong endocrine hormone disruptor. The bees get disoriented, can't find their way back to the hive. But with colony collapse disorder, you have two other conditions. One is that the bees are extremely micronutrient deficient, yet they're foraging on flowers and pollen, bringing back honey. Why should they be deficient? Except that we no longer have the nutrient density in those flowers and in that pollen that they're foraging for. The other condition is that the bees are starving while there's plenty of honey and bee bread and nectar, or bee bread and food in the hive. Bees have to have lactobacillus and bifidobacteria in the honey crop, bee stomach, in order to digest any of those. Where does the glyphosate accumulate in the plant? In the reproductive structures. That's the shoot tip, root tip, and the flowers. We usually apply the glyphosate a couple of weeks before flowering. We want to get the late weeds. Make one trip across the field if we can. And so we concentrate the glyphosate in that honey and in the pollen and nectar that they're harvesting. We found up to 20 parts per million in honey.
Oh my God.
They don't have an opportunity then to digest that food even though they've collected it. This research of Falk shows that at rates of glyphosate, levels of glyphosate that the U.S. Geological Survey has shown are present in air in the Mississippi Basin and eight other river basin areas in the United States. That concentration, and Falk was working with the U.S. Geological Survey at the time with this study, showed that that concentration of glyphosate that's in air, if it was put in the water for the bees, resulted in over a 30% mortality rate from direct toxicity. Again, it kills the biological flora in the honey crop that they have to digest that honey and bee bread. We have to have those organisms also in our honey crop, our GI tract, in order to digest our food, to have minerals so that we can absorb them, or to produce the vitamins that we need, or the tryptophan that's so critical to avoid autism, other problems. We've known for many years of the direct toxicity of glyphosate through independent scientific studies that have been published in peer-reviewed journals. You can see a half part per million is all that it takes to disrupt the endocrine hormone system. That's your pituitary, your thyroid, your reproductive hormones. You look at all of the other interacting factors, all of them below 10 parts per million for direct toxicity of glyphosate. And then you have all of the related factors that come into play. Well, how much glyphosate are we taking into the body? Study being conducted in Europe and major cities. I have four of those major cities here that this early data, the later data, supports is essentially along the same lines. And you can see anywhere from 23 or anywhere from 10 to 60 parts per million in the urine of male professional workers. This is your doctors, your lawyers, your architects, your accountants. These aren't people that have direct exposure on a farm to glyphosate. This is just through ingestion of the food. And in Europe, they don't grow GMO crops. They import GMO soybeans from the United States and Brazil and Argentina that has the glyphosate in it. Look at the dairies, how much glyphosate's there, and then realize that a tenth of a part per million predisposes them to chronic botulism. I put the EPA tolerance levels, the levels that they claim are safe, down below. 20 parts per million is fairly common. On up in oils, 40 parts per million in soybean oil is permitted. They had to double it. Companies came to them and said, hey, we're finding much higher levels of glyphosate in our food and feed products. We need to raise the levels so that it'll be safe. And so they increased those levels. I want you to look at this curve. This is celiac disease in children that it was severe enough that it required hospitalization. This is in Alberta, Canada. But look at the curve, because that curve fits 35 other diseases in North America. Directly correlated with the introduction and the increased level of glyphosate in Roundup Ready canola. They didn't have the other Roundup Ready crops at the time in Alberta. Then you can look at it for soybeans, you can look at it for corn, look at it for canola or for cotton or for alfalfa, and you get a multiplying effect as far as the amount of glyphosate that's been applied and being applied to our food and feed crops. This is a pattern that fits all epidemiological standards for cause-effect relationship with a correlation coefficient of 98. This is the increase in glyphosate per acre, also the increase in number of acres that are treated with it. Many areas, it's the only herbicide that's been applied for 15, 16 years. Then you look at all of these diseases. These are called our modern epidemics. Samsell and Seneff, in their research from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, recently published a few months ago, show that correlation, again, the same curve with all of these diseases. How many of you have a family member or a neighbor or an associate that has cancer? That question was asked at the International Symposium on Glyphosate and GMO Crops a couple of months ago that I was at in Beijing, China. 90% of the hands went up. That wouldn't have been the case 30 years ago. Doesn't matter what the disease is. When you look at those that are increasing in severity, they fit this curve. Then you have to realize that the medical data is usually 5 to 12 years behind as far as plotting. This curve is already cast in stone for one generation. That's not really reversible. We've gone from one or two autistic children 30 years ago or 40 years ago per 100,000. 1995 to 1 in 216, in 2000 to 1 in 88, to 2010 1 in 50, and it's predicted now epidemiologically that by 2020 1 in 2 children will be autistic. A crime of unimaginable consequences if looked outside the commercial relationship that's developed. Well, I just point out Morgellons disease, a disease that didn't exist before the genetically engineered cross. It's not a real common disease, but it's becoming more prevalent following this same curve. It's a disease that people itch so bad that they'll literally tear the skin off the bone. Treatment for it in the past has been Prozac and the other psychological type drugs. Try and block that itching. A little over a year ago, scientists at the National Institute of Health isolated Agrobacterium tumefaciens from these fibers that form in the muscle that create that intense itching phenomenon. Same bacterium that's used to create genetically engineered soybeans and other crops. Common soil organism in the past. What's changed? You can look at all of those diseases and you can see how those curves fit. Doesn't matter whether it's birth defects, whether it's Parkinson's, whether it's leaky gut, difficulty, diarrhea, autism, Alzheimer's, you can go down the list. But the curve is pretty much the same from an epidemiological standpoint. If it was just one or two, we'd say, you know, that kind of correlation doesn't mean very much by itself. We don't have one or two correlations. We have 35 correlations of very serious diseases. The Samsol and Senna have been able to take the biochemistry from glyphosate and the biochemistry that's involved in the cytochrome P450 and the sulfur metabolism of cysteine methionine and show how the dots are connected very effectively in that medical epidemiological process. We have the only long-term feeding study that's in existence and a peer-reviewed and published in a peer-reviewed scientific article. Study of Sir Lenny, he was beat up really bad by 210 scientists who even wanted the journal after the article and the research had been peer-reviewed by six outside reviewers and accepted. 210 scientists all having a tie to the biotech industry, one way or another, or through academia. All asked the journal to pull it and not to let it stand in the literature. The European Food Safety Authority just 2 months ago has validated this study by saying these are the protocols that will be followed for safety studies of these products in the future. 2-year study, again, what some of the findings, and these aren't all of them, but 50% of the males and 70% of the females died prematurely. What did the United Stock Growers testify before Congress of their animals? They're aging prematurely. Look at the increase in cancers, the increase in kidney and liver damage. I have a project working in Guatemala and Argentina and Brazil, a number of other countries. I just returned last week from Guatemala. I worked with Dr. Malcolm Sumner, soil scientist, epidemiologist from University of Georgia. 1 in 4 sugarcane workers in Nicaragua, next door to us, to Guatemala, will die of kidney failure this year. 25% of their male population in two provinces. 25% died last year from end-stage kidney failure. Now, Sarah Lenny shows it on a long-term feeding study. Renal failure and toxicity have been demonstrated in a number of previous clinical trials, short-term trials. You don't have to go 2 years to see kidney failure. The interesting thing is that it doesn't take a combination of glyphosate and the GMO protein. In this study, Sarah Lenny and his team of toxicologists at the University of Caen in France tested Roundup Ready corn, that had been treated with glyphosate for weed control during its growth, and 1/10 of a part per billion glyphosate in drinking water. Any of those three different groups of rats were studied separately and in combination. Both the glyphosate and the GMO protein produced the same damage to the liver, the kidney, and were all carcinogenic. I sit in the Mountain States Tumor Institute once a month with my wife, who has breast cancer or bone cancer. I think half the community is in there anymore. Follows that same curve. So if we look at the National Cancer Institute's annual report, this is a year ago, you see we made some real progress in some of those cancers. Most of those are related to tobacco. carcinogenicity that's associated with it. Some of them may be with asbestos, but with asbestos, we generally only saw the carcinogenicity when it was also associated with a smoker. Asbestos provided the lesions in the lung tissue, but it was the carcinogenicity from the tars and the other products in the tobacco that brought about the lung cancer. What's happening to those that are up above? Those are all the tissues that are targeted by glyphosate. We're going in the wrong direction. We have the greatest healthcare system in the world, supposedly, but our health is deteriorating. This generation, the Center for Disease Control says, will have a shorter life expectancy than the previous generation. That's never happened in the history of medicine. The later generation has always lived longer than the previous. What's changed? Why? Why can't we connect the dots? Why the reluctance to even do the research or to beat up and have a vengeance against anyone that does the research and tries to publish it? You get the statement of the 26 scientists that we called together to study the safety of genetically engineered crops, and after several years of frustration, they wrote an open letter to the EPA stating that because genetically engineered products are proprietary products, the companies refuse to provide access to them for safety study. Those few who've been able to obtain them are denied the opportunity to present their data. And in several cases where that access has been obtained because the companies couldn't control the isogenic lines because they were developed by a university or by another government agency, and they refused to grant that privilege of keeping everything confidential, they've been threatened with a lawsuit to destroy their career if they do publish it. And so you're kept in the dark. Most of you probably haven't seen those curves before. I served for 8 years on the quadripartite epidemiology committee for our Surgeon General. A retired colonel, retired as Associate Director of the Armed Forces Medical Intelligence Center. When we would see a curve like that happening anywhere in the world, we'd say, what's changed? Immediately initiate the research. Whether it was bird flu, whether it's hemorrhagic fever, whether it was anything else. Those curves tell you a great deal. May not tell you exactly what's happening, but it tells you you better get on the stick and get on it really quick, because the calamity's around the corner, and you don't have time to fiddle around when it reaches that level. So as we look at this massive experiment we call genetic engineering, this safe product that supposedly is the safe that you can drink it, and I can assure you that it was drunk by a number of people in South America and Asia, because it's the number one suicide chemical. Cheap, easy access, pulls all those keys out of the engines, keep your system functional. Not a happy way to go. But we see then that this combination impacts everything in our environment, our crop production, our animal production, our environmental aspects as well as us. You can't do one thing without changing the interaction of all four of those components of the environment. It just can't be done. And you don't have any voids in nature. You have changes and shifts, for the better or for the worse. And you can see all of those interactions. You look at the safety evaluations, and I've had scientists tell me why genetically engineered crops have been the most studied crops, most studied system for safety that's ever been conducted in the history of agriculture. And then you have to go in and you have to start looking at those studies. And you can go to Wikipedia. You can go into some of the other records and see what those commercial studies that the regulatory agencies accept look like. These are comments from the EPA scientists who look at those data. The bottom one down here, it's somewhat difficult not to doubt the scientific integrity of the study when the laboratory stated it took specimens from the uteri of male rabbits for examination. Well, it shouldn't have been any different. But you look at the others. Countless deaths of mice and rats go unreported. When the animals start dying, the study is canceled, terminated. Doesn't have to be reported. We evaluate for safety only on the basis of acute toxicity. That's 3 or 4 or 5 days or 30 days. Longest study's 90 days. Doesn't tell you anything about this extremely chronic toxic compound that's in our environment today that Samsung and Senef say is the most chronically toxic compound we've ever had in our environment in the history of agriculture. We have that chronology of food safety evaluations. 1991, got so bad that even EPA said, we can't tolerate this any longer, and took the labs to court. Got them for perjury, for falsifying the data, fined them $19.2 million. Got free room and board for 14 of the laboratory scientists and directors. Doesn't give you much confidence. You have the only study of premier. Objective study of commercial data that I'm aware of is the data with genetically engineered eggplant in India. The case, the farmers filed suit and said it's not safe, we don't want it, we've lost all of our sheep, all of our goats to BT cotton. We don't want this very important vegetable genetically engineered and then common in our diet and contaminating all of our other crops. The lower courts upheld the farmers, said they didn't think that the safety data was adequate. The company appealed it to the appeals court, and then when the appeals court upheld the farmers, to the Supreme Court. Indian Supreme Court said, we're not smart enough to make this decision. We need an outside objective evaluation. That's not possible with the data that's submitted to the EPA because it's proprietary data. Supreme Court assigned the data or assigned the task to the Gallagher Lab in New Zealand, an internationally recognized toxicology lab. They came back with 85 pages of scathing comments. Start with the protocol, wouldn't give you any idea of the toxicity. Wasn't set up to determine toxicity from a scientific standpoint. It was woefully inadequate. They were shifting data, control data from one experiment to another as though it was the same experiment. Totally in violation of the scientific procedural methods there and a number of others. We're in this position because we fail to honor the precautionary scientific principle. What your county commissioner or county council is doing here is merely going back to that precautionary principle that used to be the standard operating principle far as 30 years ago. When the National Academy of Science said genetic engineering is substantially equivalent to a normal breeding program, everybody said there's no need to have any safety studies because we've been breeding crops for centuries. As I mentioned, it's more like a virus infection than a breeding program. Of all the epigenetic effects, we forgot the precautionary principles. Your county council should be complimented for looking at that precautionary principle. First one, just documentation. It establishes accountability. The second one, if there's any concern about toxicity, you establish a buffer area. Whether it's in concentration that can be applied, number of acres that can be treated with a particular compound, or area between sensitive areas and treated areas. Your county commissioners have looked at that buffer zone. They've looked at merely the documentation. You won't see those medical, that health-related effect for 10 or 15 years. Takes that long for the data to be accumulated, for that data to be plotted and for you to see what those changes are. By documenting what's applied, you can go back and reference that then, rather than having to try and dig through the soil and find something that no longer exists, but that had an impact in that developmental stage. I'd summarize, and I'm probably way over my time. I apologize, Bob Strike. He has a tremendous amount of information to tell you on and share with you on remediation. Had the privilege of working with Bob for a number of years. I have a great respect for him. He's taken on a lot of challenges that most of us wouldn't do, couldn't do, or weren't in a situation that we could develop the network of scientists in that particular area related to remediation for some of these problems. But I'd like to summarize and just do it in this matter that future historians may well look back and write about our time, not about how many pounds of pesticides we did or didn't apply, but about how willing we are to sacrifice our children and jeopardize future generations for this massive experiment that's based on failed promises and flawed science just to benefit the bottom line of a commercial enterprise. I thank you very much for the opportunity to be here.